Welcome to Miss Rogers' Neighborhood. Tonight we have on Mr. Mallie, and he's one of the deans at the high school, and he's going to be talking about truancy. What constitutes truancy, Mr. Mallie?
Well, Donna, truancy is merely to be absent from school without a valid reason. Valid reasons were rather lax with some of those, or actually were lenient with a lot of these. Our system, first of all, is much like when a person is on a job. If they're not going to show up for work that day, if I were his boss or her boss, I would expect them to call in to at least tell me they won't be available. We try to liken the attendance in school to a job. We would like their parents to call in and say, my son or daughter will not be in because of an illness, death in a family. These are going to be the legitimate reasons. I really need them at home today. A pipe burst in the basement, or family emergencies. We're certainly lenient with those, no question about it. Legitimate doctor excuses. Hospitalization, obviously, a death in a family, a dental appointment, all kinds of reasons that are acceptable. Those that would not be acceptable would be if a person had to appear in court for his own actions. Now, I don't mean to say that if it's a child custody hearing, or if a person is subpoenaed before the court as a witness, they would certainly be excused for that reason. But if they had a speeding ticket or a something even more serious, and they were to appear in court, we're certainly not going to excuse them, as most employers would not pay their employee for being in court. Most, I say, for those reasons. Another reason not acceptable would be a student who has a job after school, who does not attend school. Parent calls them in sick, and then they're seen working that evening or shopping with mom or dad that evening. Now, obviously, if they had to go to a doctor that day and couldn't attend school, we'll find out from the parent later. But if they were called in sick and too sick to come to school and we see them out shopping, our school board has asked us to treat them as truants. One of the biggest problems that we have is the fact that so many youngsters wake up in the morning and say, hey, Ma, I don't feel good today. How about call me in sick? And rather than boot their tails out of bed, really, and get them off to school and get them in a good habit, they say, okay, stay in. And we have quite a bit of that.
I think we've all done that once or twice.
Shame on you. Is there anything else? I don't know if I've covered that to your satisfaction. Do you feel that that's I answered what truancy really is?
Sure, that's good. No, I was just going to ask you about some of the laws.
All right.
And there was a law change here in Illinois where didn't they shorten the length of time?
Well, the state of Illinois has been bouncing back and forth. There's been a law in the books that we must educate students to the best of their ability between the ages of 6 and 16. There are compulsory attendance laws. A parent is termed negligent if they do not send their son or daughter to school between the ages of 6 or 16 without legitimate reason. Unfortunately, even though this law is on our books, on the books of state statutes in the school code in the state of Illinois, it is only enforced in 6 counties of the 102 counties in the state of Illinois. Tazewell County is not one of them, unfortunately. I have been to meetings where in years past, where a judge has just downright stated that he will no longer hear any truancy cases. Consequently, I've stopped taking truants to the courts 10 years ago. I don't even bother wasting the taxpayers' money to go down there because absolutely nothing is done. Parents have tried. Sometimes parents can't control their own kids. I've known in many cases where the parent has brought their son or daughter to school, brought them up to my office, signed them in for the day, and when before they got to their car, the kid was out the back door. Mm-hmm. So if they can't control their students and they have them 18 hours a day and we have them 6 hours a day, we've got a problem.
Well, is there some reason why the courts won't do this anymore?
Well, they say it is not, let me think now, I can't remember the name of the organization. It's it's something like a child welfare. That isn't the name. I'm sorry. The name of the organization has slipped my mind. But they indicate that incarceration, which would be putting them behind bars or in a nice place with TV, like they do in some counties, because they won't go to school and hold them in contempt of court, they feel that the punishment does not fit the crime. They blame the problem on the schools. I've had an attorney for the state of Illinois, I've heard this gal tell a bunch of deans at a state deans meeting that if the schools did their job properly, there wouldn't be any truancy. No, my. I would love to believe that. And if that person, although she has her degree in law, is naive enough to believe that everyone will become educated because you wave a magic wand, and everyone will attend school because you have a warm place to go, warm meals, and lessons to learn. Mm-hmm. Certainly she can't be that naive. If that were the case, people from all walks of life, from the very poorest homes to the most affluent homes, we wouldn't have any truancy problems. Mm-hmm. Everyone would hunger for an education. They want to come here and learn and just rip the pages right out of the books and just love it. Now, somewhere our society has failed, whereby, and I'm not going to say the school can be a panacea in any respect that it is to say we're going to cure all of society's ills. That's ridiculous. Although I read often where these people in their ivory towers in Washington, D.C. indicate that the public school kids are getting cheated out of an education, that the minorities and the poor are being cheated out of an education, and the middle class and the affluent are getting an education. That's ridiculous. Our doors are open. We'll treat them all the same. Mm-hmm. We don't have any prejudices or biases. We'd love to have them come in and eagerly learn as much as we can possibly mm-hmm. teach them. We can offer an education to anyone who wishes one, mm-hmm. but we can't make them take it. And I defy anyone to try. We have known cases. One in particular, one I have right now. A young fellow, not yet 15, who ranks in the 99th percentile on our entrance exams, high school placement test, which means that there are not very many kids in this state or who have taken this exam are smarter than he is. Mm-hmm. Highly intelligent. He was in 3 honors classes and failed all 3. In fact, he didn't fail. He didn't pass anything. Refuses to learn anything. Now, obviously, we can't chain him to a desk. We can't make him learn anything. We can merely offer it to him. So, he has been truant, but that is not his big bag, being truant. He just doesn't want to learn anything. Mm-hmm. Pardon me. The truant, and we should really remain on truancy, and I can get off on all kinds of tangents here. Pardon me. But truant, a chronic truant is defined as a student who misses 10 days or parts of 10 days out of 40 consecutive school days, which is 25%. That's for unexcused reasons, will be termed as a chronic truant. At that point, the law should take over, which it does not. And there is a county, McLean County, does a very fine job. Champaign County does a very fine job. I don't know the other four in the state of Illinois that do it. But the ivory tower folks who have the welfare of the child, and I'll quote that, in mind, think that these judges are just horrendous. But in getting the parents before the court and the truant before the court, the judge has on many occasions uncovered child abuse, alcoholic parents, split homes, all kinds of problems. I just can't help this coughing. I'm sorry. I'm talking too much, probably.
Well, don't you think maybe putting them behind the bars like that would even teach them a lesson, scare them enough maybe that they wouldn't decide it was worth going to school rather than having that happen?
Pardon me. That used to happen in Tazewell County. A good friend of mine, who has since passed on, a judge from Tazewell County, was very pro-punishment. I had a young man that I brought down before him on one occasion who was a constant truant. I turned him in through the state's attorney, and finally, I said, first of all, the superintendent of the schools condemned him, and then the steps, all the procedural steps must be met. And then we must, thank you. I hope that helps. Oh, and all the procedural steps and remedial steps have been met, and the youngster is still a truant, then he's brought before the judge. And the judge asked this young fellow if he was now ready to go back to school, and he stood there, and he was not 16 at that time. And he says, Judge, I ain't ready to go to school. I don't want to go to school. And the judge just took his gavel and rapped it on the desk and said, young man, you just made up my mind. You are hereby remanded to the sheriff of Tazewell County, and this was on a Monday, by the way, until Thursday morning at the same time, and we'll see if you have a change of heart. I had to go back, and on Thursday morning, the young man was very eager to attend school. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, they weren't incarcerated with hardened criminals and derelicts and that type. They had a nice little place on the third floor. They watched television, and they could smoke. Pardon me. And it was very nice. But yet they were behind bars, and they didn't like that.
Mm-hmm.
But they have since stopped that. And I don't know what to tell you what the answer is. But the new people in charge now don't believe in it. Pardon me, they are very reluctant to even so much as find the parents.
Mm-hmm.
And we have, most parents are very cooperative.
Mm-hmm.
Pardon me. Most parents, and I can't say all, but most parents eagerly respond to telephone calls, where do I get them home, this type of thing. They insist that they go to school. They ask us for help. What can we do to keep this kid in school? And not only that, we find out he does this and that, and she does this and that, and what can I do? What can I do? If I had those answers, I wouldn't be sitting here earning a dean's wage.
Mm-hmm.
I can assure you that. If I had those answers, I'd be making a lot of money elsewhere saying, Shazam, your problems are cured. And I just can't do that. And people have been trying this for years, and of course, each person is an individual. There can be five or six kids in a family. Five of them can be just perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And a sixth one, or the middle one, or the first one, can be just a jerk.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing you can do. Just nothing you can do with them or her. And I'm sure you probably know some of them.
Mm-hmm.
And what do I tell you? Hopefully, they will pass some laws that have some teeth in them, whereby they can make these youngsters, if they're going to say we must educate them between the ages of 6 and 16, great, but give us some help. Mm-hmm. Again, we can't chain them to a desk, we can't lock the doors, because we'd be infringing on their rights. And everyone should have due process. And let me briefly go through some of the remedial procedures that we use. If a person is absent without valid cause, and they don't get on our excuse sheet, you know how that works, then the teacher will send them down the next day to get a pass, at which time they will try to tell us for what reason. The parent must call in the day that they're absent. Now, sometimes that's unavoidable, and they can't call in. Mm-hmm. Maybe a one-parent family, the dad's a truck driver, he can't make the call, doesn't know his kid's absent. But we'll take the call the next day. But we're very reluctant to take it 2 and 3 and 4 days later. Mm-hmm. We feel they have an obligation as a parent to call in, just as they would if they were going to miss work. Because I certainly wouldn't keep a person in my employ very long if they didn't call me when they weren't coming in, or couldn't come in, and they had a valid reason. If they didn't call, wouldn't take but about 1 or 2 times that I'd have someone to take their place, because I couldn't depend on them. Mm-hmm. And the reason I have them in my employ would be simply because I need them. Mm-hmm. And if they're not reliable, I can't use them. And I think that's a learning process that people have to go through and understand that's the way the world is. That's the way the world is when you get out of school. Too many people feel that school is merely some phase you have to go through before you go out and get a great job as president of a company. Mm-hmm. And that's utterly ridiculous. But some of them drop out. We can't control that. Their parents can't control it. They reach a point where they say they can no longer function in this type of society and quit. And we try our darndest to keep them in here. Mm-hmm. Now, back to that pass, when a student goes, the student is then either excused or unexcused at that time. Now, if the student is truant, misses the entire day, he gets 5 what we call opportunity hours. Now, we try to make that a positive thing, too. It's really a detention, staying after school, but we call it an opportunity hour, an opportunity to mend your wayward ways, okay? Mm-hmm. They spend it'll be 5 hours in 5 different days after school. If they don't show up for that, or if they cut that, we double that particular opportunity hour. Mm-hmm. So they've got more to make up. We have some that are on that list school opened August 23rd, from about the 28th to present. But they're on all the time. It doesn't seem to faze them. And I don't understand that. I would not trade an hour off during the day or 2 hours during the day for some time after school. I mean, it just doesn't sound right to me. So, but I guess if that's their bag, more power to them. We'll enjoy keeping them. We pay a person to sit with them. They must study, or at least keep their book open. No sleeping, no talking. And it's a miserable place to be, yet people evidently choose to be there. One of the favorites is taking all the lunch periods and cutting maybe an English class or a science class, and I don't understand that either, but they, for every lunch hour, if they take a triple lunch, an hour and a half, then we give them 2 hours after school. Mm-hmm. And some still enjoy that. Now, I ask them if it's worth it, and they say, well, not really. I said, why don't you change?
Well, what do you do if a student has so many, they never show up and they build up so many?
Then we're getting down to a suspension. Mm-hmm. That would be an in-school suspension. That would be the next procedure. You see, when a student is absent on an unexcused basis, we call the parent and attempt to get from about any time between 4 and 7 at night, because mm-hmm. that's when most parents are home. And we try to get a hold of the parent and tell them, hey, yesterday, your son or daughter missed this hour, that hour, or missed all day. And that's when the parent, if we get a chance to talk to the parent, of course. This is what we call our early alert system. The phone call. That's our first contact with the parent. Then we begin writing letters. And if we don't get any response, then we try the phone call again. We try for a parental conference, face-to-face, if we can get them in. we try to work out what the problems are. Say, here are the rules, they're not unreasonable, and we try to be as consistent as we possibly can. And it doesn't work for all people, obviously. About 3% of our enrollment, just nothing works for them, mm-hmm. and nothing will. But for, I figure for 97%, I think we do a fine job. Mm-hmm. And most people learn from those experiences. Now back to, they refuse to stay. In other words, they're not going to stay for their opportunity hours, right? Okay, when it comes to semester exam time, and this happened this last semester, if a student consistently cuts his op hours and we keep building them up or doubling them on him, about 10 days before the semester finals, or finals for that matter, we tell him, hey, if you don't stay for your op hours consistently between now and finals exam time, you're not going to take your finals. We're not going to let you. Mm-hmm. 4 people did not stay and just forfeited their finals. Now, they don't want to be here. They're here because their parents are forcing them in the door. Mm-hmm. They've thumbed their nose at any type of an education or any kind of discipline. I don't know what you can do with people like that. Then we go to if they totally refuse and rebel, then we go to a in-school suspension. Well, we give them a choice. You have a choice now of 3 days in school, whereby you will be given your work from every one of your classes. You will be under strict supervision. You will be in a room. You will not have any smoke breaks. You'll get one potty call in the morning, one in the afternoon. You may bring your own lunch. If not, we will attempt to get something to eat from the cafeteria. They will not see their friends all day. The supervisor is also a counselor, not a counselor that is hired as a counselor, but has a degree in counseling. She handles most subjects very well, in fact, all of them. She needs any help with any high mathematics or physics, this type of thing, she gets it from an instructor. Mm-hmm. The student is given credit for all the work they complete, and the teachers are asked to accept them, and no teacher has refused at this point, accept the work and grade it with no bias, mm-hmm. and just like they were in the classroom. If the student breaks that contract that they have, they sign when they go to the in-school suspension, then they're given a 5-day out-of-school suspension with no work, zeros. Now, they're also given a choice. So we say, you've got a 3-day suspension coming, and a student moans and groans, and we tell them the reasons. And or you may take 5 days out of school, beginning right now, including today, and you will not be able to make up your work. You get 5 days of zeros. Now, we make it that way because we want the in-school suspension to be much more attractive. And it would be very stupid to take the 5 days out. Mm-hmm. But some do. They don't want to be here. And then that kid goes home and says, Mallie kicked me out of school today, 5 days. And the parent calls all upset. Kid tells me you kicked him out of school for 5 days. I said, no, ma'am. He chose 5 days. I asked him to go into in-school suspension for 3 days. I told her how the program worked, what we did for him. We wanted to be a positive action and reaction. And I said, your son chose 5 days out, mm-hmm. after I explained the program to him. Didn't want any part of it. What do I tell you? Mm-hmm. You better talk that over with your son, but we did not send him out for 5 days. He chose it. Mm-hmm. So, let's see what else we have as far as remedial methods. Well, of course, we have the parental conferences via the telephone and face-to-face, letters, certified letters, counseling with their in-school counselor, counseling with the in-school suspension counselor. Mrs. Knapp and I are both counselors. We talk to them with reason. We don't yell at them. We have no reason to yell. We just try to reason with them. Mm-hmm. If they if they don't understand that or won't at least apply themselves after gentle reasoning, you can't force them into anything. Mm-hmm. They refuse that, then I'm sorry, we have nothing for you. We are extremely reluctant to expel anyone, but some offer us no choice. We expel very, very few students here. We'll work with them until people in other school districts think we're nuts, to tell you the truth. Why would you put up with all that? Well, we have an interest in their education, their welfare. We have an interest in our school district. We like them to learn as much as they possibly can, so eventually they can earn as much as they can. Because all we can do is offer it to them. All we can do is offer it to them. If they don't want to take it, man, I'll tell you, then we've got to go the extra mile, take them before the school board, and let them and their parents tell the school board why they should be allowed to remain in school after they've built up a record that is just utterly ridiculous. Mm-hmm. We've tried everything. We have nothing more to that will relate to their, let's say, desires to be in school. We've tried everything. Mm-hmm. And for that woman attorney from the state of Illinois that says if the schools did their job, there wouldn't be any truancy, I wish you'd come and visit our school sometime and take a look at our program and our remedial procedures and have her say that to me then. Then I'll be glad to sit down with mm-hmm. her and say, let's see the rest of your programs that you might have, ma'am. I'd certainly be interested in putting them in here if we can save any more.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that clears it up a little bit.
I hope so. I've talked myself hoarse.
There's a lot more to it. There's a lot more to it than what everybody thinks.
Well, it's a full-time job, I might add. There's never a dull moment. Well, there's times I get to sit down and look out the window, but I don't have a window in my office. But sometimes I don't want to look out the window for fear of what I'd see. Mm-hmm. But, like I say, the education is here if you want it, and I think we have a doggone good school district. Mm-hmm. And a lot of hardworking teachers and a lot of good parents in this area. And there are some parents that have turned their households over to their kids. They run the house. They're afraid of them. And when a kid wants the car, they either get the car or they're going to run away. You know? Mm-hmm. Well, that's a threat. And if they answer to those threats, then the kid runs the house.
Yeah.
And they've got problems. And consequently, we have problems mm-hmm. here at the school. And eventually, the police will have problems. And society will have problems. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if I've answered your questions to your satisfaction.
You've done a real good job. Thank you very much.
I hope so.
It sounds like a full-time job.